Communication is key. No, I'm not giving you relationship advice, though that is pretty good advice. I'm talking about survival. Many animals need to communicate with each other because it helps with hunting in groups, evading predators, and forming social bonds. Humans are no exception. Hey Jasmine, what should we eat for dinner? Hey Carly, watch out for that car. Hey Imani, let's hang out later. But we do things differently than most animals. We have names to make it easier to understand who specifically we're trying to communicate with. You might assume that humans are the only species who came up with that, but there are a few other animals that do it as well, and we are naming names. So let's talk about four animals who refuse to live in anonymity. Bottlenosed dolphins are often regarded as some of the smartest animals out there, and rightfully so. They are incredibly intelligent, which is one of the many reasons they're the subject of so many animal behavior studies. These studies have revealed that dolphins keep half their brain awake while they sleep so they can keep breathing, use sea sponges to protect their beaks when foraging around sharp corals, and can learn our words for specific objects and actions. Dolphin behavioral studies also show that they have names. In 1965, researchers were recording bottlenose dolphins and found that they were making the same or similar whistles over and over again. A later study showed this in greater detail. In both studies, these whistles were unique to the individuals, and the researchers realized that the sounds were a way of identifying themselves to their podmates. Like, hey everyone, it's Jaida, I'm just letting you know there's a predator nearby. Sometimes dolphins copied that signature whistle in order to specifically address their friend. Hey Jaida, thanks for letting us know about the predator, we'll keep an eye out. So the signature whistle basically became a name. How do we know that's what's going on here though? Surely all those whistles sound pretty similar. To us, yeah, that's why in order to tell signature whistles apart, scientists need technology. Researchers use spectrograms to visualize which calls are the same and which are different. Such methods helped them identify the unique details of the dolphin whistles. In a 2013 study, after identifying the dolphin names, researchers played them back to the pod using underwater speakers to see how they would react. When they played a signature whistle, they almost always received a response, but only from the dolphin that the whistle belonged to or a dolphin that knew who the whistle belonged to, like someone responding to a friend identifying themselves. So not only did they address a dolphin, and that individual responded, but the others knew when they weren't a part of the conversation. In the same way that I would respond to Jaida, but not Janet. Which is pretty amazing. How many of those dolphin whistles that you hear in movies and documentaries do you think are just the animals proudly saying their own names? Okay, dolphins may be quick learners, but so are parrots. People with pet parrots know that these little homies can talk. They will not only repeat a lot of what you say, like an impressionable toddler, but they'll also copy the sounds they hear from music, TV, and other pets in the house. Knowing this, researchers were interested to see if something similar would happen with parrots in the wild. One study focused on the green-rumped parrotlet, a small, colorful bird from South America. Researchers began by swapping eggs from different parrotlets nests and patiently watching the chicks as they grew up in their new foster homes. And it quickly became clear that the birds could copy sounds in the wild. To be clear though, they weren't copying random sounds of the rainforest like your favorite meditation app. Instead, they were copying names. Similar to dolphins, green-rumped parrotlets have signature calls. But unlike dolphins, these names are given to them by their parents. The chicks learn their own names basically just by hearing these calls enough to understand the association. In this study, the chicks' signature calls were significantly more similar to those of their foster parents rather than those of their biological parents. They were also more similar to their siblings' calls than the calls of chicks from other nests. All of this means they learned these names from their foster parents rather than the calls being coded in their genes. I'm sure this is useful for parrot owners as well. If you haven't yet taught your parrot its name, you should give it a try. They're pretty much built to do exactly that.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. Brilliant is an online learning platform with thousands of lessons in computer science, math, and science. You know, the stuff you probably think is really interesting if you're still watching this far into a SciShow video. And for the science-minded, Brilliant has a bunch of data content, so you can either start or continue learning about how to visualize and analyze giant datasets. And if you're more into computer science, Brilliant has you covered too. They offer lessons on everything from understanding what in the world a large language model is, to building your own programs with nesting and conditionals and all of that good stuff. And these are not abstract lessons. You get to work with real data from companies you interact with every day, like Starbucks and Spotify. And you leave with a real product, like an LLM-generated poem or cover letter. You can try it out for free for the first 30 days at brilliant.org/scishow or at the link in the description. That link will also give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription.
While we're on the topic of birds, let's talk about superb fairy wrens. The way they name their kiddos is a bit different. For these birds, names have a more important role than just your typical social bond situation. The fairy wren world is too cutthroat for friendship. Superb fairy wrens often deal with a pesky intruder. The cuckoo bird is a brood parasite, meaning they lay eggs in the nests of other birds in an effort to get someone else to raise their chicks. Parenting isn't their style, so instead they opt for forced adoption. But this takes a lot of resources from the fairy wren parents and their own chicks, so it's important for them to identify which eggs are theirs and which were laid by intruders. The problem is, cuckoos have a knack for laying eggs that look eerily similar to the host bird's eggs, making it incredibly difficult to pick out the imposter. So, in some cases, the host bird has to be able to identify the parasite baby after it has already hatched, which can also prove to be challenging. To solve this, superb fairy wrens use names as passwords. From very early on, long before the eggs hatch, Mama Wren is calling out a family name. It's unique to her nest, and her babies learn it. Yes, these chicks are still encased in their shells, but they are learning nonetheless. The poor cuckoo chick was dropped off later in the game. They tend to arrive in the nest after the fairy wren has laid all of her own eggs and will hatch before them as well. Showing up late and coming out early is bad news for the cuckoos. They haven't had enough time to learn the family name. So when they hatch and mom asks them to identify themselves, if they can't say, "Hey, I'm a Smith," they'll get abandoned. Those little cuckoo chicks are a victim in all of this, but you can't blame a mother for focusing on her own babies. Our last animal may be the coolest of all, because the way African elephants use names is very similar to the way we do. Dolphins and birds learn names by imitation, basically copying a sound that someone else is making in order to identify themselves to others in the group. When I get excited, sometimes I yell, "Woohoo!" If I were a dolphin, my friends would just start calling me "Woohoo!" But elephants are more sophisticated. Their names are, seemingly, much more arbitrary. My name, Jaida, is a collection of random sounds that are attributed to me, despite the fact that I don't regularly make those sounds. Elephants do the same thing, assigning seemingly random rumbles to each other, meaning they are coming up with novel sounds to use as names. This is something that was previously only observed in humans. Not only that, but they may also have nicknames. There's evidence that different elephants use variations of a name to refer to the same individual, which would mean elephants have to remember several names to make sure they actually respond when someone is trying to get their attention. Maybe that old saying, "Elephants never forget," applies here. Now, elephants may not use names every time they communicate with each other. I mean, do you say your friend's name every time you have a conversation with them? But these names facilitate important social interactions. These animals form close relationships with many other individuals, and being able to specifically address one of them may be helpful in doing that. And they seem to be pretty good at doing it. The way they speak to each other doesn't change based on relationship type, but by individual. For example, an adult female elephant won't speak to her nieces the same way just because they share the same familial relationship. She would speak to them differently because they are different individuals. The fact that elephants use names like we do is evidence, at least to me, that they would be the dominant species on the planet if we weren't around. But elephants are also my favorite animal, so maybe I'm a little biased. I'm now thinking of all the conversations I've had with people whose names I couldn't remember. It's so much harder to communicate with someone when the only way you can address them is, "Hey, you." So maybe it makes sense that a few other animals have figured this thing out. But I'm pretty sure we're the only species that puts our names on keychains and coffee mugs. Although I kind of want someone to put a dolphin name on a mug. Something about one that says, "Ee, ee," is very intriguing to me.